Hello and welcome to my talk about Ahmed Armour Curtain. My name is René van Gruwer and I'm going to tell you in the next minutes a little bit about exploitation and especially about how to bypass different mitigation techniques of Ahmed. So let's have a look at the plan for today. First of all, I will introduce, give you a very short introduction about my person and my company. And after that, we come to the basics chapter where I talk about different mitigation techniques like data execution prevention or address-based levelization from current operating systems and how we can bypass these mitigation techniques. I will also introduce the Firefox Array Reduce Write vulnerability, which I will use during this presentation to show you all my bypass techniques. After that, we come to the first Ahmed-related chapter. So for everyone who doesn't know, Ahmed is the Enhanced Mitigation Experience Toolkit from Microsoft, which is an application which can be used to further harden your operating system. So if you install it, you can add additional protections to the running application to protect against memory corruption vulnerabilities. The first step for my bypass techniques is always to find Ahmed DLL in memory. So the first chapter is about how we can do this. Then I will come to a chapter about advanced code reuse. And after that, we talk about the different mitigation techniques. So Ahmed consists out of many, many different protections. And today we just have time to talk about some of them. So I focus on the return or data programming protections and how we can bypass them, and on the export address table access filtering protection. At the end, I give you some final thoughts and talk a little bit about the other protections, and I will also give you a comparison between the different Ahmed versions. So basically, I have developed all my bypass techniques for Ahmed 4.1 because it was the current version. Now we have Ahmed 5.0, 5.1, and 5.2, and I will show you how much effort it was to migrate my exploits and my bypasses. Yeah. As already mentioned, my name is René van Gruwer. I'm working at SecConsult since about 3 years as security consultant and penetration tester. I wrote my bachelor thesis about exploitation and later found out that this is so a huge topic, so I just used Ahmed as the new topic and wrote my bachelor thesis now about Ahmed. So if you want, if you're interested, you can just drop me a mail and I can forward you my bachelor thesis. It has more details than I can present you today. I'm also contributing at Capture the Flex. So for example, it's the We Own You team, maybe you know us, from the ICTF or DEFCOM CTFs. And of course, because I'm a penetration tester, my interests are web application security, reversing, and stuff like that. Here's just one quick slide about our company, SecConsult. We have a team of over 50 security experts, so really persons who are doing active penetration testing and have projects all around the world. And I think the most important part for you is that we are currently hiring. So if you're interested, just drop me a mail. In my opinion, exploitation 15 years ago was quite easy. For example, if you have a stack-based buffer overflow, you just had to pad until you reach the return address, overwrite the return address with some address pointing again to the stack, for example, a hardcoded address, and place your own shellcode there on the stack in front of a knob sled, and everything would be executed and everything would work. So I think developing such an exploit was possible to make in 5 or 10 minutes. Nowadays, everything becomes harder. So first of all, vulnerabilities are harder to find, so there are no low-hanging fruits. And then you have many, many different protections there. So in the picture you see here on the left side, some of them. And the two biggest ones are here, data execution prevention, DAP, and address-based levelization, ASLR. Because in my opinion, these two protections together are the hardest part to bypass nowadays. So each protection on its own is quite simple to bypass, but if both there, it's quite hard. The idea of data execution prevention is that data should just be marked as data. So it should be just read and writeable, but not executable. So if you store something on the stack or on the heap, you cannot execute it. So it cannot execute the tag as applied code. And the idea of address-based serialization is that every recursion starts at a randomized address. So even if you can store your own code on the stack or on the heap, you do not know where it is exactly. So you don't know which address you use when you overwrite the return address because you don't know where your data is. And here you see why it's so hard to bypass both protections together. So the typical way to bypass data execution prevention is to use a technique which is called return or data programming. So instead of jumping or returning to your own data, to your own code, you are returning to already existing code. and you're chaining the already existing code together to build new logic, for example, logic to disable data execution prevention. And here's the problem. If address space serialization is also there, you do not know where the already existing code is stored because it's always loaded at a random address. And that's the reason why it's so hard to bypass both protections together. So the typical way is that you first bypass address space serialization. For example, if you build an information leakage vulnerability, then leak the base address of some loaded module. And after you know the base address, you can build a ROP chain on top of this module and abuse the already existing code. You will see this a little bit more in detail in the next slides when I talk about the Firefox vulnerability. I have chosen this vulnerability because of several reasons. So first of all, the array reduce write vulnerability is from 2011, so it's a little bit older, which means I can show you the exploitation code here. And the other reason was I think it's a very, very interesting vulnerability. It works, the exploit works reliably against all kinds of operating systems. You can bypass address-based serialization and data execution prevention. You're not using any kind of heap spraying. So one idea to bypass address-based serialization is that you can just spray your own data to the complete memory. So if your own data is at the complete memory, you can just use any address because you know your data will be there. So this is one idea to bypass address-based layout randomization. But the problem with this approach is that you would freeze the browser because you're spraying to the heap, and this would freeze the browser for 5 or 10 seconds. And in this case, if the victim goes to my website, he really sees nothing. So there's no spraying, no freezing. The browser would not crash. Everything looks like a normal web page. Unfortunately, I don't have enough time to talk about all details today. I think you can have a look at this great talk by Fionn B. Howard Davis. You can just search for this on YouTube to find it. Or you can just read my bachelor thesis where I give more details. Today, I can just give you a quick overview about this vulnerability. To understand this vulnerability, we first have to discuss the reduce function. So for everyone who doesn't know, the array reduce function can be used to invoke a callback function on all elements of an array. So let's say the callback function is a print function. You would just go to the first element, so element with index 0, and call the callback function, which is print. So print the first element. Then go to the next element, make the same, print the next element, and so on, until you print the last element. And array reduce write from the just goes from the right to the left. So it starts with the last element, so with element length minus 1, because we start counting with 0, and then prints length minus 1, the element at length minus 1, then prints length minus 2, and so on, until it reaches the element with index 0. And you see here the problem, because in JavaScript you can set the length field to any value which you like. So for example, I can set the length field here to a very huge value, like C0000 and so on. And the problem is that index is declared as a signed integer. That means index can wrap around to a negative number. And this is exactly what happens. So I can set index to a negative number, and this allows me to bypass the check if I'm inside the array, inside the scope of the array. You see this a little bit better on the next slide. So the green block here would be my array. This has a capacity of 6 elements. And if I try to access the element with index 0, it would just say 0 is smaller than 6. This is allowed. Same applies for the last element. So 5 is smaller than 6. This is allowed. If I try to access something outside the scope, like element with index 10, this is not inside my array. So this would be not allowed. And the problem is, with this vulnerability inside the array reduce write function, I can wrap the index to a negative number, and this negative number would always bypass the check if I'm inside the array. So I can access memory or space in front of my array, which is under my control. So you see here some internals of the array. So if I'm allocating an array inside JavaScript in Firefox, I would end up with this data structure here. So I have some fields describing the array. Then if I store something at index 0, it would come up here inside this green array here. Every data entry consists out of 4 bytes for the data and 4 bytes for the data type. So let's say I'm storing an integer value inside the array at index 0. It would just say here it's an integer, and here I would store the integer value. If I would store a string, it would just say here it's a string, data type string, and here I would store a pointer to the string data structure, and so on. Same applies for objects or something like that. If I store something at index 1, it would come here. But you see here, this green array has a fixed size. For example, I can just store here 10 elements. But in JavaScript, I can store an arbitrary number of elements inside an array. That means if I'm trying to store more elements than there is space for it, it would just reallocate this green array. So it would just make here a new allocation, which is bigger for more space. And for that, we have the slots array pointer. So typically, this pointer points to the start of this green array here. But if it's going to be relocated, it would just be updated to point to this new location, and every stuff from this green array would be copied to this new location. And here I have more space to fulfill my request. And exactly this I can abuse during my attack. So what I'm doing is, I just have relocated here the slots array. I have forced a relocation so that the space here is exactly 512 bytes big. And just before making this relocation, I make many, many allocations of the same size, which allows me to control the memory in front of it. So I'm just making many allocations to fill the holes in the heap memory. And after that, I make the relocation, which means I have full control over the memory in front of this green slots array. So if I'm now executing the array reduce write function, and with a length value of C0, C0, and so on, it would just use the index minus one, so it would just use the memory in front of it, which is under my control. And here you can just say, can just set here the values to something which I like. In this case, I have just set the data type to to a string. So in this case, FF00005. So the 05 says it's a string. That means the first D word is interpreted as a string pointer. I can then just say the string pointer just points again to my own data and specify there the string. For example, I can say the start address of the string is now the start address of the memory which I want to read. So I now have the ability to provide an address and read from that address. So you can now read anything from the memory space of the running application. You see here the implementation of it. I think I just go very quickly over it. So for example, you see here setting the data type, and here is the stuff for the string object. You see here how I set the length field. And with this line, I'm executing the reduce write function, providing here the callback function. So this is the function which will be invoked for all elements. This is exactly this one here. I'm just checking here if the current element is really of type string. If not, I know there is something wrong. And if it's really string, I just set the variable here, throw an exception because I do not want to iterate over all elements. So I just want to exit the reduce write function. I'm catching here at the right side. This exception, and then just return the string, and I now can read from the string. So now I have the ability to read any memory in the memory space. The next step is that we want to get code execution. We can easily do this by changing the data type from a string to an object. So we know at the start of every object, we have here a pointer to the virtual table. And inside this virtual table, we have pointers to virtual functions. And for example, here's the type of function pointer. So if you go back to the last slide, if the variable current would be of type object, I would invoke here, with this line, the type of function of this current element. So what it would do, it would just go to the start of the current element, follow the virtual table pointer, then add the relative offset here inside to reach the type of function, and then execute this function. And since I have full control over the pointer to the object, I have full control over the pointer to the virtual table, I can just let it, the virtual table, point to my own data. That means I can control all the function pointers inside this virtual table and let them point to my own shellcode. In my attack, I'm not using the type of function. I'm using the setElement function here instead because it has some benefits, because later I will modify the stack pointer. Which means after execution of the shellcode, the stack pointer is wrong. If I then just return, the Firefox would crash because it could not find the stack anymore. And the set element pointer, function pointer here has the benefit that if I'm using this one, it stores the old content of the stack pointer in some register. That means I can restore the stack pointer after execution of the shellcode, which means I can prevent Firefox from crashing. So this is the reason why I've chosen here another function pointer. You see here how the attack works. So it's the same again. I just changed here the data type to 07, which is now object. That means the first steward is interpreted as an object pointer. Here I'm following the virtual table pointer. This stuff here is the offset inside the virtual table. And here the set element pointer is just pointing again to my own data. And then I just execute my nopsled and my shellcode. And after that, I have here the opcode C3, which is just the return. So I'm just returning from the set element function. And Firefox just continues to execute after my shellcode is executed. This attack here has one problem. It would just work against very old operating systems, like Windows XP Service Pack 0 systems. In new systems, we have data execution prevention, and that means we first have to bypass data execution prevention. So typically, the blue marked memory here is stored on the heap, and a data on the heap is not marked as executable, so I cannot execute the shellcode because it would just a segmentation fault. So the next step is that I develop a ROP chain, a returnable data programming chain, to disable data execution prevention first. And here I have another problem. Because if I now let the function pointer point to any code, already existing code, then the instructions would be executed, and then I come to the return. And the return takes the return address from the stack and jumps to this address, or returns to this address. And the problem in this case is I do not have control over this return address because it takes this value from the stack pointer, and the stack pointer is pointing, as the name implies, to the stack. I only have control over stuff from the heap here, so on the red part. So my task is that I find a ROP gadget which just shifts the stack pointer to this attacker-controlled memory location with the first instruction, with the first gadget. So to find such a gadget, I have to look at the Firefox module you see here. I can find there a jump instruction. So I have here a jump and then two pop instructions and then a return. And this jump instruction consists out of two bytes. So the first byte is the opcode for the jump, and the second byte is the relative offset. And with returnable data programming, I can just jump into the middle of this instruction, so to this location here, and reinterpret it as a new instruction. So I can bring new instructions inside the module by just jumping into the middle of one instruction. So if I now reinterpret this one here, you see C9 is now interpreted as a leaf instruction, and leaf is exactly doing what I need to do. So it just takes the base pointer value and moves it into the stack pointer. And the base pointer is just pointing to my own attacker-controlled memory, and that means it's exactly doing what I want to do. I see I'm very late in time, so I'll go very quickly over this stuff here. This is a quick digression. The problem is, I have the task to find a gadget which has the behavior to take the base pointer value and move it into the stack pointer. And you see here, I have many, many different possibilities, many, many different instructions which can do this. And I just generated a catalog of already existing code which I can use and then searched inside this catalog if one of these instructions is there. And this stuff is very time consuming because if I don't find such an instruction, I have to think about another instruction which has the same behavior. And as you can think of, this is very, very time-consuming and very, very error-prone. So what I was doing is, instead, I was using PyEmu. So just make a catalog of all existing gadgets which I can use, and then I emulated the gadgets again and again for different starting register values. And then I stored the behavior of this gadget in a database, which allowed me to make behavior-based searches. So I can now make searches where I say, give me a gadget with the behavior, take the base pointer and move it into the stack pointer, but don't modify the EAX register or something like that. And this really helped me a lot. So you see just here a very quick output of the program, but I think I skipped this one here. And I'll come to the first Emmet-related chapter. It's about finding Emmet delay in memory. So if you start Emmet, the Enhanced Mitigation Experience Toolkit, you would end up with a user interface like this. In the lower part, you see the running applications, and which are protected by Emmet. So in this case, the Firefox application is protected. You see here the global operating system-wide protections like data execution prevention and address-based randomization. And if you click the apps button, you see the pair process mitigation techniques. So in this example, I have enabled all mitigation techniques for Firefox. And If I now start my Firefox exploit, you would see that it just crashed. And at the right bottom, you see Emmet has detected an attack is ongoing. So in this case, it was Emmet 5.0. The current version is 5.2. I will talk a little bit later about Emmet 5.2. But just remember for the next slides that the stack pivot mitigation technique detected that an attack is ongoing. Before discussing different bypass techniques, we have to do some general considerations. So what we really want to do is we want to protect against real-world attackers. And for me, that means we have to think like a real-world attacker. And what are the goals of real-world attackers? So first of all, I want a reliable bypass technique. So if 100 persons visit my website, I want that 100 persons are infected. So that means my bypass technique should work against all versions of Emmet. So like Emmet 3.5, 4.1, 5.0, and so on. Or if Emmet is not installed. And it should work against all operating systems, like Windows XP, Windows 7, and so on. But that means I do not want to hardcode any system codes or stuff like that, because system code numbers change between different versions of Windows. And the nice to have thing is that the bypasses should be easy to reuse. So for example, if I spend 2 weeks to implement my bypasses for the Firefox vulnerability, and 1 month later I found a vulnerability in Internet Explorer, I just want to make copy and paste and everything works again. And this last thing brings us to the idea that we build everything on top of emmetdll. So emmet works by injecting its own library into all protected applications, and then it can hook critical functions and execute some checks before executing the critical function. And you see here, emmetdll is a very good target to build all bypasses on top of it, because if the application is protected by emmet, we know emmetdll is there, and that means we can easily reuse the code. So it's always there, regardless if you attack Internet Explorer, Flash, or Adobe Reader, or something like that. Other researchers, for example, researchers from offensive security, also implemented some emmet bypasses. And for their approach, they also required that they find emmetdll first in memory. I can really recommend that you have a look at these three very good blog posts for offensive security. I will later come to their technique, what they are doing. But in their attack, they just assumed that one of the attacked modules is importing the function getModuleHandle. So what they were doing is they just executed the getModuleHandle function with the argument emmet, and the function would just return the image base of emmet. But for my vulnerability, for the Firefox vulnerability, this was not possible because the getModuleHandle function was not imported by one of the modules. So I had to develop my own approach here. And I called this approach the hook approach. And to understand this, we have to understand how emmet works with the hooking of critical functions. So as already mentioned, emmet works by hooking critical functions like virtual alloc or virtual protect, because they can be used to disable data execution prevention, or WinExec, because it can be used to execute applications, or load library, because you can use load library to load additional modules from UNC paths or from Windows shares. This can also be used to bypass data execution prevention and address-based linearization. And for example, what emmet can do is it can add a check if the stack pointer is correct. This is exactly the stack pointer mitigation technique which you saw on the picture before, which mitigated my attack. So in my Firefox exploit, I just shifted the stack pointer from the stack to the heap, because I only have control over stuff on the heap. And emmet is exactly checking this, because it checks if the stack pointer is pointing to the stack. But in my case, it's pointing to the heap. And that means emmet can detect that an attack is ongoing, because the stack pointer is just wrong. You see here how the hooking works. So this is the implementation of virtual protect. This is just a forwarding execution to another module. But this is the unprotected version. And if I protect now this function with emmet, it would just replace the first bytes here with a jump, so with the hooking code to its own code. And if you follow this code, you would end up with this code, which is allocated by emmet. And it would just go here downwards and make here a final call to emmetdll. So you see here something other important, the third push value, this one here, is pointing to this location down here, which is exactly the last start the original starting bytes instructions of the function which was hooked by Emmet. So because Emmet has replaced the instructions with its own hooking code, they have to store the old instructions somewhere in memory, and this is exactly this location. And what I'm doing now is to find Emmet delay memory is, I just go to one of the critical functions, following the hooking code to come to this location here. Then I'm just going downward here, for example, it's a relative offset. And here I have a call inside Emmet delay, so I can just extract this value here. I know this one is pointing inside emmetdll, and then I can just go downward until I find the PE or DOS header, and then I know the image base of it. So you see here a quick summary about this attack, and here is the code implementation for this. But you see here this is not so good, because I have here hard-coded values. For example, this is the relative offset from the start of the hooking code to the final call for different emmet versions, because they change. But this is not good, because at the current stage, I do not know which emmet version is there. So my exploit would just work against one specific emmet version, which is very bad. To overcome this problem, we can use the advanced code reuse technique, which I will introduce in the next chapter. So with return data programming, we are reusing or abusing already existing code. And in the case of a browser or a PDF reader, we can do better, because we know that there must be code related to JavaScript to, for example, handle strings. So what we can do is, we can just write a very, very short ROP chain, and this ROP chain just manipulates the data structure, then we are returning to JavaScript code, and then inside JavaScript, we're just working with the manipulated data structure, which allows us to implement everything in JavaScript, which is much easier than implemented in a ROP chain. I later found out that this approach was already found by Yang Yu, who described it last year at CancerQuest. So I can really recommend that you have a look at this great talk. So here are some examples what we can do. So one example is that we can just manipulate the starting address of a string and let the string point to the hooking code, so the start of the hooking code. So that means I can now implement the parsing of the hooking code inside JavaScript, which is very easy. Another example is that I can just modify the start address of an array and let the start address, the base address of the array, be on the stack. So that means inside JavaScript, I can now copy everything to the stack, which is very good because it can be used to bypass the stack pivot mitigation technique. And a third example, which is very useful, is that I can just say the start address of a string is exactly the start address of the code section of one of the loaded modules, for example, emmetdelay. And the length of this string is exactly the length of this code section. So now I have a code section, and my string is exactly over it. And then I can use search functions from this string to dynamically find me ROP gadgets. So I can just say inside the string, find me the offset for the opcode for a pop EAX instruction and a return. This means my attack would just work against all versions of Emmet without the requiring me that I change anything. So if Emmet updates to 5.3 or something like that, my exploit still works because it dynamically finds everything which it needs, which is a very cool technique. So you see here just the JavaScript implementation of it. So I'm just saying here inside JavaScript, leak me the starting bytes at virtual alloc, which is a critical function. And then I just verify inside JavaScript, is the first byte 8b, which is a move instruction. Then I know it's a standard prologue, which means Emmet is not there, so it was not hooked. So I can run the exploit without Emmet bypasses. If the first byte is E9, which is an opcode for a jump, I know the function was hooked, that means Emmet is there. And that means I have to find the call instruction to get the pointer to emmetdelay. That means I'm just looping here until I find E8, which is the opcode for the call instruction. If it's not E8, I'm just always adding the size of the instruction. So I say, if it's this opcode, it has the size of this. If it's this opcode, it has the size of 5, and so on, until I find the call. And as soon as I have the call, I can extract the image base of it and read from the PE header. At this stage, I just read then the checksum field and the timestamp field. And based on these values, I can then identify the exact version of Emmet. So in this case, 4.1 or 5.0. And based on the Emmet version, I can then apply different bypass techniques. So at the current stage, I know if Emmet is there or not. and I know the exact image space of MATLL, and I know the exact version of MAT. I now come to the different protections. So to bypass the returnal data programming protections, I have three different possibilities. So first of all, I can bypass each protection on its own. So there are five different protections. So I can just look at every protection and see how it works, and then think about a bypass, how I can bypass it. So this is described in the paper Bypassing MAT4.1 by Chatty Mott. But another good idea was developed by Offensive Security. So they found out that there is a global flag inside MATLL, and if this flag is set to false, all protections are just disabled. So what they were doing is they just wrote a ROP chain which found this global flag, disabled it, and then all protections are just disabled. With the release of MAT5.0, MAT tried to protect against this attack by encoding the pointer to this global flag, but of course this didn't work because it's quite easy to decode the pointer. And with the release of MAT5.1, they implemented the approach which I suggested. They now moved this global flag to a read-only location, because if it's read-only, you cannot overwrite the flag, which means you cannot apply this technique anymore, because you have to first make the location writable, but that means you have to first bypass all protections. And there's also another approach which works by using the system codes. So the problem is that MAT is completely in user space. And if I'm making direct system calls to the kernel, MAT has no possibility to be in between of this and add checks. So if I make direct system calls, they cannot do anything about it. But the problem with this is that hard coding system call numbers is bad because they change between different Windows versions. But we have a good way to come around this to make it very reliable, but I come to this later. And now talk about the five different ROP protections and how they can be bypassed. So the first protection is very simple, it's load library protection. It just says every time if load library is called, it just checks if the first argument is a UNC path, so a path to attacker supplied share. And if it's the case, it just forbids execution. But in my case, I didn't have to bypass this protection because I'm not loading any additional modules from attacker supplied shares. But if you want to see a bypass, you can have a look at this paper by Bypassing All of the Things by Arun Portnoy. But I think his approach just works against MAT 3.5. But I think it's not too hard to find a bypass for current versions of MAT. Another interesting ROP protection is memprotect. It just says that it's forbidden to use functions like virtual protect or virtual alloc to make the stack executable, because the stack should just contain data, and that means the data should never ever be executable. And to bypass this one, it's quite simple, we can just make another location executable. So for example, I'm making the heap executable instead. But this means we have to modify our ROP chain. So typically, we as exploit developer are quite lazy. So we're just using a tool such as Mona, which is a plugin for Immunity Debugger, which generates us the ROP chain. So in this case, this is a ROP chain which was automatically generated by the Mona plugin. And I don't want to go into all details here, but it's using the pushAD instruction to call the virtual alloc function. And this instruction would push all the arguments to the stack, which means it would just make the stack pointer executable. That means it would just make the stack executable. But in my case, I want to make a location executable which I can choose. That means I have to write my own ROP chain. So what I'm doing instead is I'm using here a push instruction instead, which means I can supply here an address which I like. I will talk about this ROP chain later a little bit in more detail. The next protection, we already heard about this one, it's the stack pivot mitigation technique. So this one just checks if the stack pointer is pointing to the stack and not to the heap. So in the case of my Firefox exploit, I shifted the stack pointer to the heap, which means it just detected this attack. And to bypass this one, we can just copy everything from the heap to the stack and then execute everything on the stack. So you see here, this is the ROP chain which implements this attack. So I think I will go very quickly over the ROP chain here. So typically, the stack pointer is pointing to this location here. That means as soon as I come to a return, it would take this address here as new return address. At this address, we have stored this instruction. So it would execute pop EAX. So the stack pointer is now pointing to this location here. So it would just take this value here and move it into EAX. Then we come to the return. Now the stack pointer points to this location here. So we would now start executing this instruction, the instruction stored at this address, which is this one here. So this instruction would just resolve the stuff and so on. It would just go downward here and so on. So the first instructions here just ensure that the EAX register is pointing to the stack. And after that, I go into a loop. And inside this loop, I'm just executing here a pop EAX. So I'm popping here the next value, which I want to write to the stack. With this instruction, I just take this value, which I popped, move it here to the EAX, which is pointing to the stack. So I'm copying it to the stack. Then I come to the next iteration. In the next iteration, I'm just subtracting here EDX, which is 4, from EAX. So I'm just going 4 bytes down in the stack. And then I'm copying here the next bytes. So I just copy the complete ROP chain to the stack. And with this last line here, I just jump to the stack and start executing the ROP chain there. Another interesting protection is the caller mitigation. So we have typically 3 different possibilities to call a function or to invoke a function. So first of all, we can just call the function, which is the valid one. But we can also jump to the start of the function, or we can push the address and then make directly a return. So it would now interpret this address here as the function return address and would return to the start of the function. And during return or data programming, we are really applying this third approach here, so we're applying this technique. And what Emmet is doing is, as soon as the function is called, it just verifies the return address and checks, goes to the return address and checks if directly in front of the return address code to the function is stored. You maybe see it here a little bit better on the next slides. So the following gadget is used by this paper by Charlie Mott. This is the way how he bypassed this stuff. So if you have a look here, instead of directly returning to the start of a virtual alloc, I'm now returning to an instruction which makes a call to a virtual alloc. So if this instruction makes here the call, it would just push this value here. This return address here. So Emmet would go to this address, go one instruction before it, and check if this call goes to virtual alloc, which is valid in this case now, which means I can bypass, in this case, the caller protection. But with this gadget here, I see some problems, because after executing virtual alloc, I have to reach this return here to execute my next code. But in between of this call and the return, I have many, many different memory references, which means all these memory references could result in a segmentation fault. And if the segmentation fault, I could not execute my shellcode, and the Firefox would just crash. So in my case, I was using a gadget inside emmetdll. So I know this gadget is always there, regardless of the operating system. And in this case, I'm calling virtual protect. I have here just one memory reference, but I can ensure that this is not crashing. Then I have here a jump, which goes directly to the return. But the problem is, what if there is no such a call to a critical function near a return? And in this case, we can just use any call to a register. So this is the ROP chain which I'm using in my attack. I will go in a second over this one here. But what I'm doing is, I'm calling or returning to this location here. I'm executing here code to ED, so I just have to ensure that the ED register is pointing to the virtual alloc or virtual protect function. After this, I take this jump to this location here, just go down and I have here the return, so there's no memory reference at all. I just have to ensure that ED is pointing to this location. And you see here how I'm doing it. So I'm just making here pop EAX, that means I'm popping the address of virtual alloc inside EAX. With this line, I'm resolving it. That means EAX is now pointing to virtual alloc. Then I'm exchanging it. So I'm just moving EAX into ED. So now ED is pointing to virtual alloc, which is exactly what I want. And then I'm popping the address where I want to jump. This is this one. And with this line, I'm just jumping to this address. So I would just jump to this address here. ED is pointing exactly to virtual alloc, and it would just work. And the last raw protection is SimExecFlow. This is the same protection as the colon mitigation, but just applied for all return addresses on the code stack. So it would just apply it for every return address. But if you bypass the colon protection, this protection is also bypassed by default. So we don't have to do anything here. Of course, we have then the offensive security approach to disable all protections, but this is not working anymore for the current version. So for AMAT 5.2, it's not working anymore. A third approach is that we can use direct system codes, but hard-coding system call numbers is very bad because they change between different versions of AMAT, between different Microsoft versions, so Windows versions. But we have something better. In this case, this is the unprotected virtual protect NTLL implementation. So you see here, this is the system call number of virtual protect. It's moved into EAX, and these two lines just invoke the system call. So it would just go here, make the sysenter, the call to the kernel. And if we now protect this this function with emmet, it would just do the same. It just replaces the first bytes here with the hooking code, pointing to this location here. And you see here, blue marked, this is the old start of the function. And this stuff is exactly doing what I want to do. It moves the correct system call number into EAX and makes the call to the kernel. And it's quite simple to obtain the base address here. And then I can just calculate the address of this system call here, and I can directly jump to this location. So I'm just jumping over all protections of emmet and making the direct system call. And after that, I'm just returning to my next code. So I can just jump over all protections of emmet. And I think this is the best approach to do, because it's very simple to use this approach to bypass the techniques. And this is also working for the current version of emmet. So I think they introduced this vulnerability with emmet 5.0, and now we have emmet 5.2, and it's still not fixed. You see here the ROP chain for this. It's a little bit longer because this ROP chain is self-patching, so it's patching itself. But yeah, it's not too hard to write such a stuff. I now come to another protection, which is the export address table access filtering. So typically, shellcode has to pass different fields, for example, the address of functions field inside the B header of kernel 32, because it has to find the function's load library and get process address. And what emmet now does is it places hardware breakpoints on top of this field. That means every time someone tries to read this field, a hardware breakpoint that is triggered, and emmet code kicks in and can add additional checks. So for example, emmet can check if the triggering instruction belongs to a loaded module or if the triggering instruction is stored on the heap. So in the case of my shellcode, the triggering instruction is on the heap, which means it's invalid, and emmet can detect that an attack is ongoing. And to bypass this protection, we have again many, many different possibilities. So first of all, we can just use a ROP gadget to read the field, because then the triggering instruction would belong to a loaded module. Or we can use the advanced code reuse technique, which is quite the same. Or we can just assume that one of the attacked modules imports the functions, load library and get process address. And then we can read the base address of these functions in the input address table. But this is not a very rare case, so don't think that this would work every time. And I think the best solution is that we can just remove all breakpoints before executing the shellcode. And we have, again, many, many different possibilities to remove the breakpoints before executing the shellcode. I think because I'm not good in time, I will just skip this one here. But basically, we have two API calls which can be used to remove hardware breakpoints. So the first one is setThreadContext, and the second one is ntContinue. And of course, we can use the associated system calls to make the direct system call to the kernel. But all of these approaches have some benefit, disadvantages. And I think the best approach is that we make the jump over the hook technique from the last chapter. So there is, for example, the function for ntContinue. And if this function is protected by emmet, the code for making the direct system call is moved into emmetll. And I can just jump to this code and jump over all protections. So I can make the direct system call. to disable, to remove all hardware breakpoints. I now come to the final thoughts. So Emmet consists of many, many more protections. So I just gave you an overview about, in my opinion, the most interesting ones, like the returnable data programming and EIF protections. But it has many more. For example, attack surface reduction, where you can say it's not possible anymore that you load Java in the internet zone. You can just load Java in from the intranet or something like that. And you see here some other protections, for example, the heap spraying protections, but bypassing these protections is not too hard from the technical perspective, so I just skipped these ones here in my talk today. But you can just have a look at the slides here or at my bachelor thesis, where I give more details about this stuff. Here's a quick recap. So what I have done, first of all, I have identified if Emmet is there or not. Then I've extracted the image space and the version of it. And then later I built everything on top of Emmet DLL. So in the slides here, I just have implemented everything based on mods.js DLL, which means you cannot copy paste my code from the slides because I don't want that you can abuse my code here to attack Emmet. If the Emmet version is unknown, we can use the advanced code reuse technique. Of course, we have here something better, which can also be used. And you see here a quick demonstration of it. So you see here, everything is green. Firefox is protected. If I click the apps button, you see for Firefox, all protections are just enabled. I go to the advanced options. You see here the EIF plus protections configured correctly. And I'm now opening the exploit without the bypasses. You see here, Emmet detected that an attack is ongoing. Firefox was just closed. If I now restart Emmet, Firefox, you see it's still protected. And if I'm now using my bypasses, you see it's just working, so I'm just executing calculator. You see nothing is freezing or crashing, so I can execute it again and again. And typically the victim doesn't know that an attack is ongoing here. Some words to the EIF plus mitigation. This is a new mitigation, I think from Emmet 5.1 or something like that. This protection should protect my current exploit, but it doesn't. I don't know why. I just talked to Microsoft, and they also don't know why it's not protecting. But but even if it would protect, it would not be too hard to bypass this mitigation as well. Here's a quick summary about the workload. So the writing the initial exploit without the Emmet bypasses took me about 3 to 5 days. But I didn't try to write it very fast because I was doing this stuff in my free time for my bachelor thesis, so I was watching TV and stuff like that while doing this. Writing then the first bypass took me a really high effort, so the exploit has about 5,000 lines of code. So it's a really huge amount. This is because I have developed many, many different bypasses for all of the different techniques, protections, and not only one for each protection. But this was good because later when I had to migrate from Emmet 5.4.1 to 5.0, it just took me 5 minutes, so I just had to add additional parsing instructions. So in the hooking code, I'm going down to find the call instruction, and I'm always saying, if this opcode is this, the length is this. So there were just 2 new assembly instructions which I just had not implemented yet. So I just had to specify the length of these instructions. With Emmet 5.0, with the release of Emmet 5.1, it took me about 40 minutes because they tried to destroy my scan down hooking approach. So as soon as I have a pointer to Emmet DLL, I'm just going downward to find the PE header. And what Emmet is now doing is it introduced a hole in between of the code section and the PE header. So you now have the code section, you have the PE header, and there's a hole of unmapped memory in between. So if I now go just downward, I would try to access memory inside this hole, and if this memory is not mapped, it would just segmentation fault and close Firefox. So what I'm now doing is I'm just search for the start of the code section, As soon as I have identified the start of the code section, can subtract the offset of the hole and go to the p header. And of course, with image5.1, it took me about 5 minutes because I just had to change the signature of the code section start because the starting bytes just changed. So you see here how this worked. So this here is the address where the p header is stored. It has a size of 1,000. And if you add the base address with the length, you just come to the start of the code section. See here, the text section. Same applies for MH5.0. Base address, size of 1,000. If you add both together, you come to the text section. And here with MH5.1, you see it's not the case because we have here a hole. So this is the base address, 1,000. If you add both together, you don't come here to 1,000. You have here a hole in between. So what I'm doing is I just search for this address here. And as soon as I have this address, I can just subtract 2000 and reach the p header. You see here the picture. This is MH5.1. And this is a newer one. This is the current version, which is MH5.2. So you see all protections are enabled. And you also see here in the debug output that I detected that it's MH5.2. And of course, calculator popped up. Here is some contact information. And yeah, thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, you can just ask now or come to me later.